Today's action and January's goal of the month, all in the company of Jonathan Bungate and Dion Dublin. Join us on BBC One after the news.
Yes.
This is BBC One Wales, now at 10 o'clock, the BBC News, with Michelle Hussain.
Michelle Hussain.
The Queen has tested positive for coronavirus and is said to be experiencing mild symptoms. The news comes ahead of her 96th birthday in April and in her Platinum Jubilee year.
96? Found out that she was ill on the way here, so it's quite upsetting. I hope she's all right.
We want her to recover very quickly. And we want to see her back to herself again as soon as possible.
At the same time, a new living with COVID plan for England is about to be unveiled. We'll be looking at the changes. Also tonight, we're on the front line in eastern Ukraine as soldiers face the possibility of a Russian invasion.
Ukrainian troops here tell us that they are ready for whatever may come. But no one knows what that will look like. Storm Franklin is headed for Northern Ireland. An amber warning for wind is in place, and we've already seen severe flooding.
Great Britain have won the Olympic title.
And a gold medal in Beijing in the final hours of the Winter Olympics.
It's curling.
Good evening. Buckingham Palace announced today that the Queen had tested positive for coronavirus. She's said to be experiencing mild, cold-like symptoms and is expecting to be able to continue with light duties at Windsor Castle this week. The news came just 2 weeks after the Queen marked 70 years since her accession to the throne and ahead of her 96th birthday. Here's our royal correspondent, Nicholas Witchell.
I'm here.
Windsor Castle on Wednesday, the Queen meeting defence officials. The only health issue then was to do with her mobility.
Good morning, Your Majesty. How are you?
Well, as you can see, I can't move.
A woman in congratulations from the start.
That exclamation, "I can't move," is thought to indicate that she may be having knee or hip trouble. But now, after 2 years of careful shielding from the risk of COVID, it's clear that the virus has penetrated Windsor Castle. Several staff have tested positive, and so has the Queen. In a statement, Buckingham Palace said, "Her Majesty is experiencing mild, cold-like symptoms, but expects to continue light duties at Windsor over the coming week. She will continue to receive medical attention and will follow all the appropriate guidelines." Those light duties are expected to include continuing with the paperwork as head of state. Shortly after the palace confirmed that the Queen had COVID, she sent a message congratulating the Team GB women's and men's curling teams on their medals at the Winter Games. The main concerns of the Queen's doctors will focus around the fact that she's now just 9 weeks from her 96th birthday.
Any person of that age will need to be monitored fairly carefully. And also, I think, given antivirals, we do know that if you give antivirals early on in an illness, you can substantially reduce the risk of severe disease.
The Queen is thought to have been fully vaccinated against COVID, and if she is given antiviral drugs, they should protect against serious illness. Political leaders were quick to tweet their good wishes. The Prime Minister said, "I'm sure I speak for everyone in wishing Her Majesty the Queen a swift recovery from COVID and a rapid return to vibrant good health." The Leader of the Opposition, Sir Keir Starmer, tweeted, "On behalf of myself and the whole of at UK Labour, wishing Her Majesty the Queen good health and a speedy recovery. Get well soon, ma'am." In recent days, both the Prince of Wales and the Duchess of Cornwall have tested positive for COVID. The Prince, who met his mother at Windsor on the 8th of February, has already made a full recovery. It is to be hoped that his mother will do the same. Nicholas Witchell, BBC News.
And Nick's here in the studio with me now. How will the palace deal with the level of public interest there'll be in how the Queen's doing, Nick?
Well, the palace has a very straightforward, though from our point of view not entirely helpful, attitude to all of this, which is that essentially it is a private matter. So there will be no bulletins, there will be no updates. If we have something to say, we will say it. If we don't, we won't, is their approach. For the royal doctors, of course, the priority now is to ensure that these symptoms, which are described at the moment as being mild, do not deteriorate into something worse. The Queen has been triple vaccinated, so we understand, though the palace won't confirm that. She's also, of course, a believer in homeopathic medicine, and there is the possibility of these antiviral drugs. The big imponderable in all of this, as I said, of course, is her age. Anyone of 95, nearly 96, is going to be considered to be vulnerable. Now, the medical household has had lots of time to think about this, to make a plan. They've been very successful in protecting her against the virus for these past 2 years. A bubble was created around her. They will hope, obviously, that they will now be very successful in treating her. And for her part, the Queen, I'm sure, will wish to be very stoical about it and continue as much as she can with those light duties.
Nick, thank you very much. Well, the news about the Queen came as the government prepares to unveil a new plan on living with COVID in England, which includes dropping the legal requirement for people to self-isolate if they test positive. In a BBC interview today, the Prime Minister also indicated that he wants to reduce the amount of testing. Here's our health editor, Hugh Pym.
Everyday life with COVID has involved many guidelines on how to keep safe. That won't change. But the big shift tomorrow will be the announcement that remaining laws governing public behaviour are set to be scrapped in England, including the requirement to self-isolate after testing positive. And PCR testing sites will be wound down, though the government says the ability to monitor the virus will be maintained. Free lateral flow test kits are likely to be cut back, with availability only for those most at risk, and that could prove controversial.
We need resilience, but we don't need to keep, for instance, on testing, we don't need to keep spending at a rate of £2 billion a month, which is what we were doing in January.
The key thing is that people have access to free testing, they know their status, and they do the right thing by staying at home.
Scotland's health secretary said the UK government must continue to fund testing in any nation where there's health advice to keep it. More generally, there's a plea for detailed and comprehensive guidance for the public.
Thank you.
Restrictions can end, but we need that to happen with provisions for people that are clinically vulnerable. We need that to happen for those that need to take time off work to be able to do that safely, both for their health and their finances. So there needs to be an awful lot of planning around this.
The latest survey by the Office for National Statistics suggests that just under 3 million people in the UK had the virus in the week ending February the 12th. That was lower than the peak, but still relatively high. But with daily COVID hospital admissions, there's been a continuing downward trend from over 2,000 at one stage to closer to 1,000 a day.
Was clearly this concept of...
And the NHS is trying to move forward after intense COVID pressure.
It is time to recover. It is time to try and get things back to normality. I'm afraid this virus is with us. You know, we are inevitably going to see more variants emerge in the fullness of time. But we have better tools of dealing with this, both in the community and in hospital. That's probably going to be okay.
Hospital staff will hope that responsible public behaviour will continue as the government's plan for living with COVID is implemented. Hugh Pym, BBC News.
Well, the new plan for COVID in England comes as the police continue to investigate whether the Prime Minister and others in Downing Street broke any COVID rules. Our political correspondent Damien Grammaticus is here now. The lifting of COVID restrictions in England, Damien, previously talked about for March.
Yes, it was due to these restrictions were in place until for another month, actually. The lifting of them was signalled about 10 days ago or so, and it still needs to be decided by the full cabinet tomorrow, but that should be followed by a formal announcement there. Now, what Boris Johnson says is the time has come to move away from legal restrictions to guidance backed up by vaccinations and medical treatments. But many are not convinced. So Labour saying, yes, this is a Prime Minister under police investigation. They say he was acting to seek good headlines about a victory over COVID. So acting out of political considerations from political weakness. And they say that move is premature. Education unions also saying that they think that this is reckless and designed to appeal to conservative backbenchers. It's worth saying that the government's own messaging about this says that the pandemic is not over and its future course is deeply uncertain.
Damien, thank you very much. President Putin is said to be prepared to pursue a diplomatic solution to the crisis over Ukraine. The assessment has come from the French government after a phone call between Mr. Putin and President Macron. Russia continued to carry out military exercises with Belarus close to Ukraine's northern border. Our Eastern Europe correspondent Sarah Rainsford reports now from the Ukrainian capital, Kiev.
These drills in Belarus were meant to end with Russian tanks rolling back to their bases. But all this firepower is now staying put indefinitely, not far from Ukraine's border. In a crisis that's all about signalling, this is Russia refusing to de-escalate.
Let's really take a moment to understand the significance of what we're talking about. It's been over 70 years. And through those 70 years, as I mentioned yesterday, there has been peace and security. We are talking about the real possibility of war in Europe.
Russia is talking up the danger too, helping evacuate women and children from the breakaway regions of Ukraine it controls, claiming Kiev is planning an attack there. So President Macron phoned Vladimir Putin today. The Kremlin did agree to continue seeking a diplomatic solution, but its troops are still in place, despite the threat of sanctions.
And we have to accept at the moment that Vladimir Putin is possibly thinking illogically about this and doesn't see the disaster ahead. And I think it's vital for us all now to get over what a catastrophe it would be for Russia.
But for Russia, this is all about pulling Ukraine back into its orbit.
8 years ago, Ukrainians came out in huge numbers on this very square to demand their independence, the right to decide their own future and direction without Moscow dictating. They paid a really heavy price for that, but the feeling is stronger than ever now.
So they're preparing to resist here any way they can. This was self-defense for women for a wartime scenario. Pretty extreme, but so are the predictions of Western governments in this crisis. Sarah Rainsford, BBC News, Kiev.
Meanwhile, the Ukrainian government has said there's been more shelling and mortar fire in the east of the country, where separatists backed by Russia have held two areas for the last 8 years. The ongoing conflict there has claimed 14,000 lives, and there are fears Moscow could use any escalation as a pretext to invade. Our international correspondent Orla Guerin reports now from one of the front lines at Novotroitska.
The tempo has changed at the front lines in eastern Ukraine. It's a lot more active. We stopped dead because we heard the rumble of shelling. It was time to pick up the pace. And there were other hazards along the way. We moved carefully past minefields on both sides.
We're covering the distance now to the front on foot. Ukrainian troops here tell us that they are ready for whatever may come. But no one knows what that will look like, what Vladimir Putin's endgame is. And if it is a full invasion, then Ukrainian troops will be quickly outnumbered and outgunned.
Taras, who's 24, shows us defensive positions against Kremlin-backed rebels less than half a mile away. They've been opening fire with heavy weapons for 3 days, he says. The situation has gotten worse, but we tolerate it and we wait. I think Putin is doing it on purpose to provoke us, so it looks like we are invading. Nearby, a crossing point that leads to the separatist enclaves. There's tight security for civilians traveling from Ukrainian government territory to the other side. This is one of only two locations where people can cross to reunite with loved ones. The East has been painfully divided for 8 years. It takes permission and patience.
You sure?
Just ask Larissa, who does this every 6 months. She's a cancer patient returning home after a checkup in a government hospital, hoping the worst won't come. We, the people, don't want a war to happen, she tells me. We want to live. We want to love everyone and give them a hug. Svetlana is coming in the opposite direction from separatist territory with great difficulty. A grueling trip for the 81-year-old. We couldn't see our children for 2 months, she told me. Our great-grandson was born. We hadn't seen him. Now we have. There are very real fears for Ukraine and for security in Europe. And beyond the geopolitics, here on the ground, the human toll could be immense. Orla Guerin, BBC News, Eastern Ukraine.
Nearly 60,000 homes in England and Wales are still without power in the wake of Storm Eunice. There are also more than 150 flood warnings in place for the north of England and the Midlands, including two severe danger to life warnings in South Manchester. Tonight, a new storm, Franklin, is coming in. James Reynolds reports.
In Todmorden in West Yorkshire, the flood warning is impossible to ignore. Storm Franklin is coming. In Otley, the River Wharfe is rising. Franklin follows Dudley and Eunice all in the same week. The UK is working its way through an alphabet of storms.
The Met Office has issued another amber weather warning. This is for Storm Franklin. It's actually for the north coast of Northern Ireland, and it's valid from midnight tonight until 7 a.m. Monday morning, where we're going to see potential gusts of winds in excess of 80 miles an hour. But I also want to stress that we could see damaging gusts of winds once again across southern Scotland, northern England and parts of Wales.
Thank you so much.
In Devon, Caroline Bullock and her 91-year-old mother, Kathleen, are still recovering from Storm Eunice. Their homes lost power, along with 20,000 others in the west of England.
Friends have been fantastic in bringing us thermoses of hot water for hot water bottles to keep my mother warm.
In Kent, energy companies have gone up in helicopters to search for broken power lines. But repairs are slow. The village of Wadhurst in East Sussex lost power on Friday morning, and 80-year-old Carol Robbins hasn't had any official help.
Normally, at someone my age, they turn me as vulnerable, so they would ring or send texts, but I've heard nothing from anyone. So I have no means of finding out other than other people when it might come back on.
These pictures of rising water levels were taken today in Bakewell, near the River Wye in the Derbyshire Dales. And Omagh in Northern Ireland has also seen its water levels go up. The wider region now braces for the strong winds of Storm Franklin. James Reynolds, BBC News.
Well, Northern Ireland is already feeling the force of Storm Franklin. Let's join our correspondent Emma Vardy, who's in Newton Ards. How severe is it likely to be where you are, Emma?
Well, the winds are steadily building here. The storm is expected to peak overnight and into the early hours of tomorrow morning. And Northern Ireland really taking the brunt of this one. Winds forecast to be around 80 miles an hour in coastal areas. Stronger winds here expected than any other part of the UK. And it has already been a day of disruption here in Northern Ireland, with lots of roads closed due to falling trees and floodwaters. More disruption expected too on transport, ferries crossing the Irish Sea, for example, and more disruption expected too at Northern Ireland's airports. Now, you might think we've been taking quite a battering lately, and this Storm Franklin is the third named storm in a week for the very first time since the storm naming system was brought in 2015. So if you're in the eye of it here in Northern Ireland, expect to hear the wind howling outside overnight. Quite dangerous conditions if you're out in it. We'll assess the damage tomorrow morning when that amber weather warning here ends at 7 a.m.
Emma, thank you very much. And of course, BBC weather teams will be keeping you updated wherever you are. Now, the entrepreneur Jamal Edwards, who founded the online urban music platform SBTV, has died at the age of 31. His YouTube channel was instrumental in the development of UK grime and rap music and helped launch the careers of Skepta, Emily Sandé and Ed Sheeran. YouTuber. He was awarded an MBE in 2015 for services to music. The Winter Olympics ended today with Great Britain winning a gold medal in the final hours of the competition. Victory for the women's curling team came a day after a silver in the men's event. Those were the only British medals of the Games. The closing ceremony saw thousands of athletes parade through the Bird's Nest Stadium in Beijing, and Andy Swiss was watching.
It's curling gold! Saving the best till last. A glittering finale to Britain's Games as Eve Muirhead's team delivered the perfect ending.
This could be the most important stone of the match.
Curling is so often a sport of cliffhangers. Not this time. Britain led Japan from the off, and a moment of Muirhead magic took them out of sight.
It's four for Great Britain!
Triumph was now only a matter of time, and when Britain extended their lead to a massive 10-3, enough was enough.
And that's it!
And so a team which only just squeaked into the semi-finals were now Olympic champions. For Muirhead at her fourth Games, it was particularly sweet.
It is a dream come true for myself and for the rest of the girls as well. Like, it's been a journey to get here. Olympic champions, and what a five we are, and it's such a special, special moment.
So forward.
Oh, and it's crashed! It's crashed!
Aside from their two medals in the curling, though, the truth is Britain have struggled here. Their target was between 3 and 7 medals, and they failed to reach it.
And he's crashed!
There are definitely athletes and teams going home disappointed that, you know, we're not going to hide away from that. It would have been nice to have achieved some medals on the snow and also on the skeleton and bobsleigh. So we'll go home and we'll make sure we review that properly and understand what happened.
Suitably, it was the curlers that led the British team into the closing ceremony.
And so the end of the Games, which were contentious before they even began, taking place against the backdrop of COVID and concerns over both sustainability and China's human rights record.
And they were dominated by a sporting scandal of the Russian 15-year-old Kamila Valieva, who was cleared to compete after failing a drugs test. But despite everything, the head of the Olympics said the Games were exceptional and the athletes an example to the world.
May the political leaders around the world be inspired by your example of solidarity and peace.
Things like that, ain't you?
And finally, the flame was extinguished and the fireworks ignited. A colourful end to one of the Olympics' most controversial Games. Andy Swiss, BBC News, Beijing.
And that's it from us for tonight. On BBC One, time now for the news, wherever you are. Good night.